shit to claim your fame. It's the biggest cringe offender. The more success you see, Weston Chandler. But I mean, when was the last time that you got laid? Your stories never match mine. They're only played up for yourself, not made for no one else. Whoa, whoa, oh, you're acting like a child. Over an idea that's not even yours. And hilarity's been short, cause of a bullshit game show.
When it comes to videos I actually put effort into, the Ken Penner's video has been my most popular to date. It's easily the reason I have an audience at all right now. I'm pretty sure as of the original upload of that video almost 2 years ago, I had almost 200 subscribers. 34,000 views later, I'm now on my way to 2,000. Despite this, you'd be surprised to find out that my Ken Penner's video is one I'm pretty unhappy with, as many nice and not so nice commenters love to remind me, over and over, I got a few details wrong, and I feel like I perpetuated rumors and misinformation about this crazy dude. That, believe me, is crazy enough without the wrong information. So let's do this again, shall we? Welcome to the tale of Kenneth the Penneth. It's the early 90s, and the Sonic the Hedgehog brand is explosive! Sonic was a super big part in pop culture with the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade float, an aggressive advertising campaign, and tons of multimedia projects in the works. That means toys, cartoons, albums, and comic books. Early on in 1992, Deke, the studio known for Inspector Gadget and the Super Mario Bros. Super Show, was developing two cartoon shows based on Sonic. These two shows were Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog, this super goofy and lighthearted show that put Sonic and his buddy Tails in this cartoony world pulling Looney Tunes-esque schemes against the villain, Dr. Robotnik. The other show, far more integral to the story, was simply titled Sonic the Hedgehog, but is referred to by fans as Sonic Set AM due to its Saturday morning time slot. This show featured a far darker tone, but not quite like Sonic 06 levels of dark. More like, we got all these goofy, furry cartoon characters in this bleak world, and they're fighting to reclaim it. I love this show, I think it's a premise that really works well for Sonic. Sonic himself has always had a rebellious attitude, so making it so Robotnik already won gives him a world to rebel against. The show also introduced the character Princess Sally Acorn, a character whose father's kingdom was overthrown by Robotnik. She works with Sonic as a kind of love interest, but also to keep Sonic grounded. It's a neat dynamic you don't really see a lot in the series. While we're on the subject, I'd like to introduce you to a writer for Sat AM, Ben Hurst. Hurst only worked on one episode in the first season of Sat AM, but come season 2, he became one of only 3 writers for the series. This led to him being a writer on so many classic episodes. He pushed the show to tell an ongoing narrative, something kids' cartoons weren't doing a lot at the time. His work includes almost exclusively my favorites in the entire show. I should also mention, he didn't work on these episodes alone. He occasionally worked with Pat Ali, but Hurst's contributions are important for later. However, Ben Hurst's push for the stronger narratives unfortunately became the reason many fans were left in the dark. The final episode of season 2 ended on a huge cliffhanger where Snively, Robotnik's abused assistant, became the new villain. However, season 3 never came. The series got canceled in 95 due to low ratings. But let's rewind here for a minute. Back before the show even started, it went through a lot of changes. The supporting cast, for one, was totally different. Once they decided on the Freedom Fighters, Princess Sally went through numerous design changes. Rotor the Walrus was called Boomer in a lot of older material, and Bunny Rabbit didn't even exist. In this early state of the show's development, but after the show was greenlit, is where the Archie comics started. The Archie Sonic comics began in 1992 with a short miniseries featuring most of the cast from Sat AM. Snively and Bunny are noticeably gone, but whatever, I guess. Anyway, the comic began with the goofy tone of Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog, just with the setting of Sat AM. What you get here is a very cheesy romp not worth reading at all today, unless you were a kid in the 90s. Because the Sonic series was huge at the time, the miniseries ended up being pretty popular. So popular, it warranted its own full series. This went on to become the longest-running American comic book without relaunching, with a whopping 290 issues, plus a fuckload of miniseries, spin-offs, and all sorts of weird, 48-page specials. As it progressed, the series started to find itself tonally. It began to match with the cartoon, and believe you me, it ended up surpassing it by going way overboard in melodrama. So it's the mid to late 90s. Both the cartoons have been canceled, and Sonic isn't as popular as he used to be. The games on Genesis lit up the gaming world when they were new, but now it's time for the next console generation. Every series is going 3D, and Sega's working way too hard on their next 3D Sonic game. But it just wasn't panning out. A main series Sonic game never came to the Saturn, so the Sonic brand was dying. Aside from spin-offs, all Sonic had was the comics, which were miraculously still pumping out every month.
Yeah, so for the past like year or so, I've been a really big collector of Sonic comics. I don't have a ton, but I like the ones I have. I got Sonic Archives, which I've had since I was a kid. This is a collection of a lot of the classic stuff, and I'm trying to focus because I'm fucking stupid. But, it's not in the best shape, but, yeah, you know, it's got a bunch of stupid... I think it's just the miniseries, the beginning miniseries from 92, whatever, it's all shit. Don't read it. This one's interesting, it's called Sonic First. So they do these Sonic Super Special things, and those are really cool. They're always these 48-page epic stories and stuff. So I picked this one up, thinking it would be, like, cool like that. But it turns out, it's the only Super Special that's reprints of old comics. So once again, fucking garbo. I have two issues of the newer run. This was Ian Flynn's run, I believe. Yeah, so this is, like, towards the end. I think this is, like, 2016. These issues are from... whatever. I think this is a variant cover. And I have a handful of IDW stuff, like the trade for the first three issues. I like it. Wait, what the fuck? Is there a Pokemon card in here? What the fuck? Just like Archie, I have two random issues of IDW. This one is definitely a variant cover, and it's pretty fucking cool. And then for the 30th anniversary, I had to pick up this, the 30th anniversary comic, and I have read this, and I love it. It's phenomenal. I couldn't find the Spaz cover, and then when I found it later, it was like $56, so I was not buying that. But this cover's pretty alright.
The comic got, well, pretty crazy after a while. There wasn't a lot to work with for Sonic before Adventure came out in 98, so this book just went nuts. It introduced plot lines about characters' love lives, focused a ton on Knuckles' extended family. Had a ton of weird tonal shifts, like, yeah, the world is supposed to be dark, but sometimes it, like, forets that this is about a blue hedgehog. I'd argue the domino that set this chain of craziness in motion, though, is my boy Ken Penders. And with that, we finally have our protagonist. Or, anti-hero? For the first few issues of Sonic, the head writer was a dude named Michael Gallagher, but in 93, word around the office spread that he might be stepping down. When the editor Paul Castiglia caught wind of this, he scrambled to find potential replacements. Paul sought out a gent by the name of Mike Kantorovich, who did end up doing a little work on Sonic, but Mike told Paul that he didn't know jack shit about the Sonic series, and recommended his friend Ken Penders. This probably counts as nepotism. Ken himself wasn't a huge Sonic fan or anything, but the key point here is that his son and niece were... Dude, imagine if your mom was out there writing, like, I don't know, fucking Deltarune fanfiction or some shit. Anyway, Ken wrote a few stories freelance for Archie, and Mike Kantorovich was just there to kind of help him. Penner started with issue 11, back when the comic was goofy. This issue starts with a story where Sonic, trying to get back to the Freedom Fighters as fast as possible, takes a shortcut through the Cosmic Interstate, some psychedelic-ass world between dimensions. He takes a wrong turn into an opposite world, where Robotnik is the sweet old veterinarian, and Sonic and the rest of the Freedom Fighters are all evil. Evil Sonic in particular wears a leather jacket and sunglasses. This'll kind of become important later. Sonic the Hedgehog is a licensed property, and just like any media that comes from a license, the license holder is gonna have restrictions set in place. This is probably my biggest gripe with the previous Ken Penders video. I said that later events caused by Penders directly led into stricter mandates, but that isn't the truth at all. The truth is, however, that the mandates were never looser for this franchise than at the precise moment Ken entered the scene. Sonic had a very tenuous sense of brand synergy from 92 to 94. I am gonna go off on a bit of a tangent to set the scene, so bear with me, dear viewers. At Sonic's very inception, he was designed to be a rival to Mario, as we all know. Artist Naoto Oshima designed the little dude after many, many pitches and rejected designs from all over Sega. The whole vibe of the character Oshima was going for here was this cute rubber hose inspired animal character with a little bit of an attitude, but it wasn't quite the point. The point was being cute, right? The aesthetic of the world, and you do see this in the final game, is like this weird, almost computery, psychedelic world with sharp shapes and random geometry. You can see this in a lot of the Japanese box arts of the era. On top of what does get seen in the final Sonic 1 is a mountain of shit you don't see. The concept art for some levels go way harder on the psychedelic feel, and most known is Sonic's band and a human girlfriend that both got cut from the final game for being too Japanese. That's Sonic. That's what Sonic was intended to be from the get-go, right? However, Sonic might have been a Japanese-made franchise, but he was primarily designed for an American market. So then you got, like, Tom Kalinske and Madeline Schroeder and all those Sega of America and shit, and they come in and they're like, no, bro, you got all the shit all wrong. Get that fucker a mohawk. Get that guy, Greg Martin. Yeah, get him to do the art. God rest his beautiful little soul. That new Knuckle guy, he's real cool. Let's go hard on him, and let's try to get the Nike logo on his chest, because this dude is... It's the fucking 90s! Sonic has an attitude! Don't do fucking drugs! But then you take all that and transition it into Adventures of Sonic, where it's just Looney Tunes, and Robotnik's just being a big ol' palooka, and he's hanging out with two dumb old robots, and Sonic comes in at the end and tells his moral and not to do fucking drugs. Then at the same time, we got another cartoon, and this is the super serious one, and Sonic has a friend in the first episode that gets captured, and he visits him in prison to assure him that he's gonna find a way to get him out. And next time Sonic shows up to his cell, he's not there because he got fucking tortured and died. Then you take that and turn it into a comic with the exact same dark premise, but now it's played for laughs? Do you see what I'm fucking trying to say here? Sonic never had a consistent tone, and he still doesn't. That's why Sonic attracts so many weirdos, because everyone latched on to a different version of Sonic. Sonic's not the only one, of course. Spider-Man has a million different comic reboots and movies and cartoons, video games, novels, whatever, fucking right? Spider-Man in Victorian England. Spider-Man is a 40s noir movie. Whatever, who fucking cares? But the heart of Spider-Man is always the same. It's always at its core about a kid who gets spider powers, who has to balance the weight of the world on his shoulders while attempting to balance a normal social life. And when a piece of Spider-Man media gets that element wrong, people fucking hate it. Anyway, what I'm trying to say, in my own stupid, stupid way, is Ken had a lot of freedom, and the mandates were loosey-goosey. And even with the characters taken from every game at the time, and both cartoons, there wasn't a lot. So, of course, Keenus the Penis had to make some characters of his own. Jeffrey St. John, like Miyamoto, is a skunk. He's a member of King Acorn, or Sally's father's, Secret Service, and as such is supposed to be super well-versed in combat, as a Royal Guard. He's also a fucking horrible, annoying character. The whole idea behind his character is that he views the main Freedom Fighters as kind of childish, whereas he's more put together in combat. Sonic in particular is a huge rival of his because he conflicts with Sonic's fast and loose personality. The main point of stupidity, though, is his love for Sally. Jeffrey is super in love with Sally, and that's what all of his appearances really boil down to, at least early on. Some big thing has to be done to stop Robotnik, then fucking Pepe Le Pew appears out of nowhere proclaiming that he has the biggest cock in all the land and is cool and more epic than you, and Sonic's like, no, I'm better! And then they bicker, and then they have to do the thing together, or whatever. Sally is portrayed early on as super in love with Jeffrey, too, and it's super weird. Sonic and Sally are both, like, 15 canonically, whereas Jeffrey is said to be in his 20s. Fun fact, did you know? On Ken's wonderfully infamous Twitter, he tweeted about how he initially planned for Jeffrey to take Sally's virginity, because Sonic wasn't fast enough in that department. There's Dr. Quack, the greatest doctor in all of Mobius, apparently. Funny that despite his skill, he's named after the idea of a quack doctor, or a doctor that doesn't know what they're doing, but okay. You got some real great ones like Nicolette the Weasel, who's just a female Fang the Sniper. And he made Archie versions of Sonic's parents. Sonic's dad, Jules, is really just Sonic with a tuft of hair, so that's really cool and original. His wife, Sonic's mom, is named Bernadette, after Ken's own wife. Then you got old Robbo the Hedgehog, Amy Rose's cousin. Who is, he's just a more teal Sonic, but he's also Robin Hood, so these are just great characters, really. Now, of course, if you're familiar with Ken Flanders' OCs, you're probably like, what the heck, dude? There's like a whole world you haven't tapped into yet, and yes, you're correct. But think about all the virgin eyes that don't know what's coming. Would you really want to ruin that for them? Would you really want to ruin the impact of Knuckles? Knuckles the Echidna first appeared in Sonic the Hedgehog 3 in 94 and was already insanely popular. I'd go as far to say that Knuckles could be responsible for the height of Sonic's cultural recognition at the time. Everybody loved Knuckles. He was this badass counterpart to Sonic back then, but now sadly he's just a big idiot in most modern games. The second Sonic movie, however, does kind of go back to that characterization for Knuckles, thankfully. The early comics held this dynamic wonderfully. Knuckles first appeared in issue 13, and a lot of his future appearances in this era were sparse, only using him to show the reader that shit is serious. Sonic would often begrudgingly ask him for help when things would get dire, and often the two would have these awesome fights. Super Sonic vs. Hyper Knuckles is a personal highlight, where the two fight in their super forms. And of course, my personal favorite super special issue, Mecha Madness, where Sonic gets roboticized and Knuckles has to get himself roboticized too so he can defeat him. He uses a, like, inhibitor chip to keep his free will, and then he kicks Sonic's ass. It's pretty cool. Before carrying on here, I'd like to just remind you all who Knuckles is, in game canon. In Sonic 3 and Knuckles, he's the last echidna in the world, his sole purpose in life being the guardian of the Master Emerald. The Master Emerald is like this Chaos Emerald, but it's bigger and betterer. It keeps the island Knuckles lives on, Angel Island, floating in the air. There's a little bit you can look into in the game too, like that the Master Emerald has the ability to power up Chaos Emeralds into the Super Emeralds, and that there appears to be prophecies in the like cave paintings and Hidden Palace Zone, but that's about it really. Knuckles gets tricked into helping Eggman, but by the end of the game he realizes Eggman's just stealing the Master Emerald and he becomes friends with Sonic. It's simple. Ken Penners was in charge of a lot of Knuckles' stories early on in his appearance in the Archie comic. Eventually, I can only assume, he got the reputation, perhaps lightheartedly, as the Knuckles guy. So Penners would be put as lead writer of every Knuckles story. In the main story of the Triple Trouble special, which was not written by Penners, just so you know, a little bit of lore is dropped. Knuckles wakes up in a cave to find himself face to face with the Ancient Walkers, three entities known from legend. It's not too crazy though, as this story is pretty lighthearted. They tell him that if a Chaos Emerald is ripped in half, like it is in the story, it'll fuck shit up. Then they have him sniff the weed they just bought or something. But the Ancient Walkers are a weird idea, almost out of place for this goofy-ass special. But then there's this weird page. At the end, there's like an epilogue where the Walkers summon a Chaos Emerald and the narrator proclaims, "An age-old prophecy has been fulfilled, and the cycle begins anew." Then at the end of the issue, Knuckles gets his own side story, and Vector the Crocodile from the game Knuckles Chaotix shows up and is drawn really badly in this panel. They did a whole Knuckles Chaotix issue too. The main story just served to properly introduce the characters from the game, the Chaotix. Vector the Crocodile, Charmy B, Espio the Chameleon, and Mighty the Armadillo. They're all now friends with Knuckles. In the first bonus story of the issue, Espio finds a weird shadowy creature that is clearly a small Australian ant, so it's not a very intimidating shadowy figure. Okay, I'm not gonna go plot thread by plot thread here, but basically they were dropping these, like, weird sprinkles of Knuckles lore, and they were all kind of out of place if you ask me. Still though, this was all building up to something. The next big thing is the A Sense of History arc that took over the main Sonic book for several months straight. I mean, 1996 was like the year of Knuckles. Every single issue from January to May had a Knuckles solo story, and then he got his own book! Anyway! A Sense of History, which was now a joint writing by both Penders and Kantorovich, delves into Knuckles' ancestors and their big-ass Kryptonian utopia and whatever. Dude, these were fucking boring! Anyway, it follows these Knuckles scientists, and this one's named Edmund, I think. And this guy is, there's this guy, Dimitri, who's, he's Knuckles' uncle. And he's mad at Echidna Society for not using technology anymore, so he is evil now. And he gets, like, I think, he gets possessed by this entity called Enerjack, or maybe he becomes Enerjack. I'm gonna be real, this is the most fucking boring shit, I don't care. Enerjack is the super evil godlike figure, that's all you need, it's stupid. The whole point of A Sense of History is to finally culminate in this three-issue miniseries. Sonic's friendly nemesis, Knuckles. Finally, they got all the dumb Knuckles crap out of their system, and the storyline can finally be wrapped up.
Wrong!
The miniseries introduces Archimedes, the shadowy ant guy from before. He'll come to act as Knuckles' sidekick for a good while onward. Apparently, get this, fire ants and echidnas have historically had this strong relationship, and they helped with the formation of Angel Island in the first place. Arky could also literally breathe fire, and he's a pretty good illusionist sometimes, I don't know. Never really thought this character was anything special. I will say him and Knuckles have this pretty nice dynamic sometimes. It's nice to see this early hostile version of Knuckles actually have something of a best friend. This miniseries also brings in Enerjack as the main villain, who's been freed from being crushed under rubble for years accidentally by Knuckles. Enerjack has some chaos powers, but he doesn't use them for some reason. He's this frail scientist, so he doesn't really know how to fight, so Knuckles kicks his ass. But that makes no sense because he has literal god powers! Anyway, some rockets come out of absolutely nowhere and clamp onto the tower they're in, and Enerjack gets put into space. Shit's nuts, dude. The miniseries ends with a little dun-dun-dun moment because it shows that Locke, Knuckles' father, is alive and is watching over him in the shadows. Ooh! Okay, we're done. Just like I said before, all the crazy Knuckles stuff can die down. It's all good now. He can go back to just being a character in this world with his crazy backstory, but still ultimately not being this big main event with his own side stories, at least for a few years. We had our year of Knuckles, let's dial it back a little. This is, after all, Sonic's book, right? So Knuckles Quest! Knuckles' Quest, like A Sense of History, is a multi-part arc that gets stapled on the end of the main Sonic series. Basically, Knuckles' Quest was pure setup for the coming full Knuckles series that would run alongside the main Sonic book. Finally, we have a hazardous waste zone to contain all the Knuckles OC bullshit. And that led to the Knuckles lore growing on its own with little outside influence, like a plague developing in a petri dish or some shit. For the purposes of this narrative, I'd be remiss not to mention the opening arc of this series, the Dark Legion. All you need to know is that they're a clan of echidnas living in the shadows. Let's talk about Locke for a minute, Knuckles' aforementioned dad. Did you know that, like, immediately after Knuckles was born, Locke did all sorts of chaos energy experiments on his egg? He threw that fucker in a microwave, making omelets and shit. He infused Knuckles with chaos energy, essentially making him a living chaos emerald and mutating him to have his iconic Knuckles spikes. Knuckles' mom, Laura Lee, ends up divorcing Locke, and there's a whole arc where she goes and remarries. And then she gives birth to this little fart, and his name is Kneecaps! I love him! Anyway, Locke ends up dying to fucking pancreatic cancer in the future. This officially licensed and published Sonic the Hedgehog fanfiction about Knuckles' dad dying to pancreatic cancer is dedicated to Ken's dad, who died 24 years prior. So what is the obsession with Knuckles? Was Penders just a huge fan of the character and wanted to make fanfiction? No. Knuckles, as I said before, didn't have a lot of established stories. Sonic was a mascot. The leash on stories to be told with him were tight. But Knuckles? You could do whatever you want with him, and boy, he did! Before moving on, I think it'd be fun to check out some of Ken's other wonderful additions to the Sonic mythos. For we must look to the future. 25 years later, to be exact, with the story, Mobius 25 years later, yeah. Mobius 25 years later is a story arc that began in the middle of another fucking story arc in issue 131. It obviously is a look at a possible future for these characters, focusing primarily on Kenny Boy's favorite focus, the echidnas. Echidnopolis is now this bustling futuristic city. I don't know how that happened in 25 years, but whatever. Knuckles looks like this hardened treasure hunter now with this hat from the OVA, which is a cute touch. He's also sporting a robotic eye for some reason. Anyway, he settled down with a last named Julie Sue, who, fun fact, is a distant relative of Knuckles. They had a daughter named Laura Sue. Laura Sue, the Sonichu to Ken's Christian. Laura is Knuckles' daughter from the future. But anyway, she really wants to be the guardian of the Master Emerald just like her old man, but he won't let her. Laura has to go to her unveiling, which is this event that all 16-year-old female echidnas have to go to, apparently. Okay, so this comic just cuts back to Rotor and a new character, Kobar. They barely have chemistry at all, and you assume they're co-workers or something. But Ken Penders, in later years, did a J.K. Rowling and swears up and down that he intended these two to be gay and that he was super ahead of his time. There's one line that even implies this to be true, and it's the most clunky shit I've ever read.
My dear Rotor, and I say this with affection and respect, have you gone mad?
We need some gay reps, especially in kids' media, and especially with dudes. But this ain't it, Chief. You don't get your Twitter points for that clunky as fuck line. Try again. Anyway, there's a bunch of totally original characters like Vector the Crocodile's son, Argyle, who is a smaller Vector. There's also Salma, who is Espio the Chameleon's daughter, who is Espio with hair. I love these amazing character designs so fucking much. I mean, look at this wonderful 2003 era artwork by Steve Butler of all of these characters with human-ass proportions. Sonic's got the most detailed eyes in the world, and spines that go to his fucking feet, I love it. It's wonderful. Dude, part 4 of this arc is in the same issue as the infamous Slap, which is a story perhaps I'll save for another day. But really, what the fuck was going on with the Sonic comic at this time? So much nutso shit happened in 2003 for real. Yeah, so Rotor tells Knuckles that he thinks the world is ending because there's lightning or something. And there's this evil chick named Lian Da, and she likes to hang around the preserved floating robotic head of Dimitri and yell at her kid who has the Krillin dots on his head. This comic is too fucking weird for me, man. I'm just gonna move past it. Some other highlights of Pender's tenure. Let's see, Charmy B has a friend that overdosed on lemon sundrop dandelion, not LSD, and fucking died. He's dead. Evil Sonic disguises himself as Sonic and is implied to have had sex with Bunny. That's rape. There's this time he tried to kill off Sally. Yeah, so, but because the Saturn era marked a downhill trend for Sonic's popularity, they were setting up issue 50 as a finale to the comic, with a big arc leading up to it called the Endgame arc. Fun fact, today, Penders goes on Twitter and claims that he's the reason that the word Endgame is popular, taking credit for the Avengers movie using that title, failing to understand that it's a chess term. Anyway, the Endgame arc must have been hype as shit at the time, especially when a lot of the issues beforehand never told such serious stories, but going back today, it's just kind of a ripoff of The Fugitive. Also, Sonic throws dirt from his shoes into the air and then runs up it. At the beginning of the arc, Sally falls and fucking dies. Ken intended this to be it, with her just kind of fucking dying here. He says this on the subject.
Main reason I wanted to kill off Princess Sally back in the day. Felt she made Sonic into a second banana and cramped his style.
Of course, the comic didn't end after Endgame because it was bringing in too much money and the editors made him revive her. It doesn't seem like that huge of a deal, but in the Archie comic and Sad AM, Sally is probably the most important character plot-wise, so it was a strange-ass choice to begin with. There's this time that he rewrote a famous poem about the Holocaust to be about Sonic the Hedgehog characters, like an edgy Weird Al or something. There's this whole thing about Nazi echidnas in general there for a bit, it was a whole thing. Penner's worked on Sonic Super Special number 7, a big crossover with Image Comics, the publishing company known mainly for Spawn. Image Comics, the company built on the foundation of beef its founder, Todd McFarlane, had with the Big Two, DC and Marvel. He founded Image with the sole mission statement of paying independent creators for the characters they made for their comics. Sometimes history has those fun little rhymes. Oh yes, of course, there's Sonic Live. This was a funky adventure where Sonic forcibly makes two kids from the real world come to the video game realm and help him murder Robotnik or something. He meets his creators and finds out that he's a fictional character. It's fun stuff. When it shows the real world, the kids are actual photos of real-ass kids. These kids are Ken's son and niece, by the way. This cover is so fucking scary. Sonic's not only poorly drawn, but he's huge! And he's grabbing this kid's arm really hard, too. Alrighty, moving on. Remember old Ben Hurst from earlier? Well, the year is 2003, and even though Sad AM ended almost a decade ago, he was still incredibly passionate about it, and regularly engaged with its fanbase on his website. The show ended way too soon, and it wasn't just the fanbase wanting more out of this world. Ben was right there with them. One day he met with Deke about the possibility of making either a revival season 3 or perhaps a film to conclude Sonic Sad AM. Believe it or not, Deke was all for it. Of course though, Sonic is a licensed property, so he had to meet with Sega too. He briefly talked with an executive, and describes the conversation as very pleasant. But she had to cut it short for a meeting, telling Hurst that she'd love to talk with him more about the idea. The next day, he got a phone call. It was Ken. Ken Penders decided to call up Ben Hurst because he caught wind of this potential Sonic Sad AM movie. Hurst told Penders his strategy.
Get Sega to become invested in the idea by hiring us to interview their creative game designers, execs, etc., and see if we could develop a storyline that would fulfill the third season, and simultaneously give them creative ideas to develop new games. A win-win situation.
Then he called the Sega exec back, only for her to explode on him. It turns out Penders went behind Ben's back, told Sega his strategy in a super unflattering way, and used this opportunity to pitch them his own movie. This ended the final chance for Sad AM to ever get an official conclusion. Ben Hurst passed away from diabetes complications in 2010, and Sad AM with him. But don't worry, cause we came closer to getting fucking Sonic Armageddon instead! Sonic Armageddon was Ken's pitch for his own Sonic movie, presumably based on the Archie universe. While it's impossible to tell exactly how far in development it got, probably not very, it did have a lot of pitch materials made for it. This includes 4 pieces of concept art and a wonderful pitch video. Let's jump into this video head on, shall we? It starts with a production logo, Floating Island Productions. It's obviously Angel Island. Not even trying to hide his obsession with stealing Knuckles shit, huh? Okay, so it shows the kids playing Sonic CD. The kid narrating tells us that the stories in Sonic games and TV shows and comics, those are all just what got out into the public. And that it's all based on real events. And his dad, who works in space travel, knows what really goes on. Guess he was just kinda chilling in the background the whole time watching Sonic fight Robotnik and shit. According to this text, by the way, I guess he was developing this with Larry Houston, a guy known for working on the X-Men comics. Huh. Anyway, I don't know, it's dumbass shit. Sonic's a little baby, he finds a hoverboard, and he fucking dies, the end. It obviously didn't end up turning into a movie. We're all so lucky. You'd be wrong if you assumed Sonic Armageddon was Ken's only escape from the shackles of comics. In the early 2000s, he wanted to break into the larger entertainment world in general. In particular, television. He cut his teeth working on a few shows here and there. He worked in the art department for 2 episodes of King of the Hill, which I found interesting. But for the most part, nothing of note. Of course though, as we all know, Penders had bigger ambitions. Penders, of course, did work here and there on other comics besides Sonic. For Image Comics, he spearheaded The Lost Ones in 2000. A story about superpowered individuals with limited resources against a world that wants to hunt them down for being different. What's X-Men? Anyway, it was cancelled after only 1 issue. Strangely enough, there was a crossover with Lost Ones and Sonic in 98, 2 years before these characters were even established. Stop me if you heard this one before. Penders, under his studio, Floating Island Productions, pitched around a mock-up trailer for a movie adaptation. Anyway, he claims that this movie has been in production since 2012, but I'm pretty sure the trailer is all that exists. The trailer itself is pretty wild.
There you go.
Not quite what you expected?
The trailer also claims that it's based on a best-selling comic book. Again, couldn't even get past issue one. Penner's had a history of strongly over-exaggerating his success. Finally, there's The Republic. Penner's is amazing satire of right-wing American culture that predicted Trump, apparently. Yes, he just worked on two episodes of King of the Hill and then immediately tried to make his own version with none of the charm, subtlety, or nuance. What a hack. Also, I asked him on Twitter if he considers this still in production. He does. The pitch pilot came out in 2010. Alright, enough setup. Let's get into the shit, shall we? In 2006, Ken Penders finally left Archie. I can only assume that this was to pursue his Hollywood dreams. Anyway, for the next few years, things were business as usual. Then we skip over to 3 years later, in 2009. Penders' wife suggested, hey, maybe you should copyright your characters. I mean, you made them, you should own them, right? And I agree, actually. As an artist, I heavily believe in the ownership of your work, even if it's for a licensed property. But the part that is really jogging my noggin is that he signed a contract when he first started, stating he totally understood that he didn't own these characters, right? So if he's gonna protest that, then why now? Why 3 years after quitting instead of before he joined at all? Well, the copyrights were approved in 2010. How? Because Archie didn't even contest them. They had the chance to, they were informed and everything, they just kinda didn't do anything. Well, not yet at least. They filed a lawsuit, like, way too late, in November of that year. This was now a public case. Then, on top of that, in 2011, Penders did the old Uno reverse card thing and sued Sega! Yeah, so in 2008 they did this game called Sonic Chronicles The Dark Brotherhood. It was an RPG developed by BioWare, who are known for Mass Effect and Star Wars KOTOR. Anyway, the game was about an underground tribe of echidnas, all in hiding, called The Dark Brotherhood. This sounds vaguely familiar, doesn't it? Well, of course it does. This is the Dark Legion arc in Archie, Ken patent-pending Penders' story that he did for the Knuckles series, remember? Yeah, so I never played Chronicles. Heard it was mid. Sorry, Mr. Flowlight. But I can certainly see a case here. So Ken filed a suit against Sega, EA, and BioWare. The case was dismissed fucking twice, but Sega never did make a second Chronicles game, even though the first one ended up on a cliffhanger. So who knows, maybe Penders scared him. Maybe just a little. Anyway, that case got done thrown out. Back in the Archie case, it really should have been easy peasy for Archie to win that one, right? I mean, it's right in the contract that he doesn't own shit, right? Right? Where's the contract, Jim? What do you mean you don't have it? Archie suddenly fired their entire legal team in 2012. Okay, so they had a photocopy of the contract, but Penders claimed it to be a forgery. It also wasn't even from 1994 when he started, it was from 96, so the contract wasn't even usable. This whole thing was such a train wreck. There was no fucking reason Archie couldn't destroy him in court, but due to incompetence, the whole operation just went up in smoke. After Penders quit Archie, they appointed a new head writer, Ian Flynn. I am a big fan of Ian Flynn. You could say I'm based in Flynnpill. What's great about this era of the comics is that, as Flynn puts it himself in his podcast, they play with all the toys. The comic uses all sorts of previous characters and established lore, even those from when the comic was goofy as hell, and he and the other writers find ways to incorporate them into a more game-accurate world, doing away with a lot of the cringe. They even bring in characters and concepts from all sorts of corners of the Sonic series, including obscure characters from the games and even the cartoons. It's peak Sonic, really. Remember Evil Sonic? If you don't recall, in a super early story written by Ken Penders, Sonic travels to an evil dimension where morality is comically swapped, as a parody of DC's many old school multiverse stories. Robotnik is a kindly old veterinarian, and Freedom Fighters are all evil. Evil Sonic wore a leather jacket and had a much meaner attitude. As the comics got more serious, they'd periodically revisit the evil characters, introducing even more evil universe characters, like Knuckles, except he's French. Well, as I said, Ian Flynn likes to reintroduce old concepts and make them work with the more game-accurate stories he and the other writers like to tell, so he took Evil Sonic and made him into a fan-favorite character, Skurd. It all starts in Sonic the Hedgehog number 160, which, funny enough, is Flynn's first issue of the comic, back in 2006. Coincidentally, this is Tracy Yardley's first issue of the main series, too. I feel like this issue is something of a fresh start. Anyway, the issue starts with Sonic having a surprise birthday party. However, Bean the Dynamite and Bark the Polar Bear are two characters that, especially in 2006, were pretty much forgotten. Anyway, they crash the party to distract all the Freedom Fighters. Meanwhile, Rouge the Bat goes to steal the Master Emerald, but is surprised to see Evil Sonic there. Apparently the two are in cahoots, and Evil Sonic was supposed to help distract the Freedom Fighters. While the two bicker over this, Locke catches them and they fight. Evil Sonic sneaks off while Rouge and Locke are occupied beating the shit out of each other, and in classic Evil Sonic fashion, betrays her and starts to harness the Emerald's chaos energy. Locke interrupts this process, however, permanently changing his appearance to his now iconic green color.
Evil Sonic.
Not quite, babe, but a real scourge all the same.
Man, this issue has an ad for Lego Batman sets and the DVD release of the Goblet of Fire. So much nostalgia. So that is the proper introduction to Scourge. He was originally created by Penders as a simple evil clone of Sonic, but then after Penders left, he was molded by other writers into a character all his own. He's a traitorous maniac hellbent on ruling not only his own world, but Sonic's too. He even has his own super form that's purple instead of the typical yellow. Put that in your pocket again, it'll be important later. So back in 2012-ish, around the time of the lawsuits, Archie quietly stopped using a lot of the Penders characters, and many fans feared the worst. Their fears were realized in 2013 when the comic officially got rebooted in the Super Genesis Wave. But what is the Super Genesis Wave, you may ask? You fucking would! Okay, so it's issue 251, right in the finale of the Mega Man crossover. Yeah, that happened, and it was fucking awesome. Anyway, Eggman and Dr. Wily are preparing to launch the Genesis Wave, a sci-fi-ass wave that uses Chaos Emerald to change reality, which is how the Mega Man and Sonic universes converged in the first place. Okay, so Mega Man and Sonic are on the ropes. Eggman and Wily have all 7 emeralds and are ready to fire their fully powered Genesis Wave. A Super Genesis Wave, if you will. But of course, their friends break them free, and there's a big-ass fight scene, and the evil scientists get into a big mech. This art is fucking amazing, by the way. Big fan of Tracy Yardley's current style. Or more current, this was like 9 years ago. Both Sonic and Mega Man go super, and it's so cool when Mega Man goes super, it's like his rush adapter in a series, it's called Super Mega Man, so it makes sense. Ugh. Okay, so they beat the doctors, but it looks like the Super Genesis Wave is about to overtake reality. Sonic proposes they use the Chaos Control, which if you've never played Sonic Adventure 2, is this move using a Chaos Emerald to similarly reshape reality. Sonic uses the Chaos Control and resets everything in the way it was in the beginning, sending the Mega Man characters home. But not everything is the same, because you see, this was their excuse to do a soft reboot. Every Ken Penders character is fucking yeeted from existence. They play with this a little, Sonic tries to grapple with the horror of remembering people that ain't exist, but yeah, that's it really. Mega Man's world seems fine, but the Genesis Wave seems to have had the long-term effect of erasing the world from existence because his comic just fucking ended. Wait, Sonic's did too, what if that's the canonical reason? Yep, Sonic went on for a few more years, but in 2017, unfortunately, in the middle of an arc retelling the classic series games, it just ended. Could this be because of Penders? Well, sales steadily declined since the reboot. I think it's a mix of both as to why the comics ended. Sega must have been sick of Archie's incompetence and jumped at the opportunity to get a new publisher with a new continuity. This was not only the longest running comic based on a license, it was the longest running comic without ever getting rebooted. And Ken killed it. No one man owns Sonic. Yuji Naka, the lead programmer, says he is the father of Sonic. Naoto Oshima, the man who designed Sonic, might think himself the creator. Madeline Schroeder, of Sega of America, is known as the mother of Sonic for reinventing him in the West. But one man, Ken Penders, potentially owns 250 Sonic characters! The old Archie crew are now on a new Sonic series for IDW. It's been going strong and has introduced plenty of its own characters that are now fan favorites in their own right, among which are Serge the Tenric, who is a green character that mirrors Sonic, much like Scourge. Ian Flynn has been campaigning hard to implement the Freedom Fighters in the IDW series, and is writing a document detailing all of his cut content from before the book got canned. It looks like IDW is the future of Sonic comics, and likely to go on for many years to come. But what of Penders? Good old Ken has been up to some stupid bullshit in the coming years. Nothing crazy ever happens, though. He mostly just bitches on Twitter, swearing he's working on projects for years and years for them to just go nowhere. There have been some goofy-ass shit since my last video. Basically, he's been allegedly working on a comic or graphic novel or something that continues the story of his characters. It's called the Lara Sue Chronicles, and it fucking looks like this. He swears up and down that it's canon, or at least fits into the original continuity, if the Super Genesis Wave never happened. I guess Sonic, Mega Man, Wily, and Eggman all just die or something. Knuckles is in it, but he's called Nox the Ichnia or some shit, I don't know. They're not echidnas, they're all aliens called Ichnias. To be copyright distinct, whatever. He just started talking about this shit in 2011 and he still posts about it coming soon, dude. He'll post up and down that Espio's daughter is amazing autistic representation or whatever, but it's basically all headcanon. So what even is the Lara Sue Chronicles anyway? It's kind of hard to tell. He doesn't say much about it besides it's coming soon or it's gonna be a movie or some shit. But here's what I can gather. It takes place after the Mobius 25 Years Later stories, with that cast of OCs, sans the Sonic characters, of course, except Knuckles, who, like I said, is renamed to Nox. Julie Sue, Salma, and Jeffrey St. John are all there. There's this human character, and he's just traced photos of Anthony Mackie. This is such a strange tale. Again, it's so hard to find any actual information on this comic because he doesn't post a single thing of substance. Even if this comic were gonna be good, we'd never know. Penders offers his characters for license. Like, yeah, fuck you, pay me and plaster my name everywhere, and you could do whatever you want with him. He also demands that you plaster his name over fan art of his characters too. He's a cunt, for real. At one point, these guys paid him so that they could use Scourge. Yes, Ken Penders owns Scourge. Because he created Evil Sonic, he owns the green Sonic named Scourge with the personality of Scourge. He didn't make any of that. What he made was Sonic with a leather jacket. It's such bullshit. Anyway, these guys announced a comic series called Scourge the Speed Demon, made by them with no involvement of Penders himself, except his fucking name all over it. Really the modern Stan Lee, this guy. Everyone clowned on this announcement all over Twitter, and so the official Twitter got all sad about it and canceled the comic. Also, it came out that one of the guys working on it was an actual for-real Nazi. Fun stuff! Let's see, there was an official Sonic Encyclopedia written by none other than Ian Flynn. It had a section on Sonic Chronicles, proving Sega still owns that game's characters. Penders refuses to accept this and swears up and down that he owns Shade the Echidna. Speaking of Ian Flynn, he's really been thriving as of late. He's been writing the upcoming Sonic Frontiers game, and Penders cannot stand him. He's seething and mauling over the mere existence of Flynn, and it's really funny. He's constantly bitching about him on Twitter. Dude did nothing to him but replace him. I think Ken's just salty about Locke dying. And yes, of fucking course he wants to do NFTs. Are you surprised? Look at all these Knuckles variations. Of fucking course he wants to do NFTs. Most recently, the second Sonic movie came out, and had a Knuckles backstory flashback featuring Knuckles' dad briefly. A version of Knuckles' dad that looks absolutely nothing like Locke, I might add. He also tweeted about a comparison between these scenes of Sonic riding on the tornado. Like, you do know you didn't come up with that, right? It's taken directly from Sonic 2. Ken went off and said he might sue Paramount over this shit? Yeah, that's not happening. Paramount is such a massive company, he'd never stand a chance, and I think he knows it. Also, literally right as I started recording the script, news came out of the new Sonic cartoon, Sonic Prime. The cast was revealed, and according to IMDb, so take this with a grain of salt, Locke the Echidna is a listed character, which is endlessly fascinating. Also, I learned thanks to a commenter by the name of Prick Sama that a character in the cartoon Sonic Underground was actually taken straight from Ken's Archie lineup, Athair. Make of all this what you will. Ken Penders' story ends so anticlimactically. The truth is, he's just pathetic. He just bitches and bitches to no one about nothing, and swears he's making his comic about nonsense to no one. It's sad, really. The best we can do is observe and not engage. He's truly a man-child and always has been. He thrives on the hate he gets online. It's really depressing. A few other Archie people have expressed wanting to come and take their characters like Penders before them. Nothing has came of this yet, but who knows? Ian Flynn is moving up in the world of Sonic, going from lead writer, just like Penders, to working on the encyclopedia for the comic, to an official encyclopedia for the games too. He led the IDW comics in the beginning, creating a ton of new characters that are actually well remembered, and now he's writing a main series Sonic game. Fans are carrying out the legacy of SadAM, making an entirely fan-made third season of the show. Even though Ben Hurst can't anymore, his legacy lives on. There's now an official major motion picture based on Sonic. Not just one, but two! And they're crazy popular, making the second movie the highest grossing American video game film of all time. That just wouldn't be the case for Penders' Sonic Armageddon. There's so many talented and not so talented people that make the Archie Sonic comic. Carl Bowlers, Tyson Hess, Mike Gallagher, Scott Fulop. It's a shame, really, because when people bring up these comics, they often think immediately of the lawsuits and Knuckles clones. Who knows, maybe I'll do other videos on other Archie Sonic related tales. Let me know if you'd want to see that. And with that, it's over. Thank you all so much for the support on the previous Ken Penders video and all my other videos, and a huge shout out to Agikopop for letting me use her badass Ken Penders diss track, and thank you all for watching. Remember to like if you liked the video, dislike if you didn't, I don't give a fuck. Subscribe for more lay epic content, and comment why I'm horrible at making content down below. As for promotions, I have a webcomic on alfytales.com and a Twitter for art at supersprited64. That's all for me. I've been Sprited, and thank you for watching my video.
Yeah,
I know. No, I'm just seeing it, like, is that good?
Oh, yeah.
So you're going to be an old man?
I know, I'm just seeing, I'm just trying to get the fucking, like, beat tone.
You need to be old, though, is
I know.
Thing? Can you just, like...
I know what you...
You know what? Maybe he's not ready for this line. Okay, in, like... I don't know, maybe 50 years? Yeah. I think 50 years? 50 years good enough? Well, 55 years.
I'm not gonna
come
live,
back to us?
I'm not gonna live that long.
45 years. Come back to us?
45 sounds good. That's a good answer.
Give me
nice
9 years and no longer, because I'm probably not gonna live past that.
I don't feel like that won't really be cold.
No.
Not even middle age, I feel. So
it's
I mean,
not
I don't,
good
I think,
enough.
I'm sorry, we're gonna have to cut the puck. Is your dad free?
He can't just be middle aged. He has to be old.
I know. That's what I mean. Is your dad free?
Is
your dad around?
Afford makeup?
Could you give your dad a little ring on his phone? Does he have a cellular phone?
His
dad isn't old enough.
If he can find my dad.
If your dad doesn't have a cell phone, then he's perfect for the
He is perfect. He's exactly
so
what we're looking
for. I mean, it's going to be harder to get a hold of him if he doesn't have a cell phone, but if he doesn't have a cell phone, he's exactly what
You're just
needs,
not going
to
be able to make it in this business.
I have a dad.
I'm sorry, you don't have the range that's really necessary.
News to me.
You're going to be blacklisted.
I'm sorry. We're gonna have to blacklist you.
I don't think you can say that anymore. That's like
I.
You never.
Actually, blacklisted means you can't say anything anymore.